I'm Steve Spangler, and I'm all about making science fun. For the last 20 years, I've been teaching ways to turn ordinary science experiments into unforgettable learning experiences. I have an amazing team who will do whatever it takes to affect the way people think about science. And to do that, I live by one motto: make it big, do it right, give it class. Okay, you got my change?
Yeah.
You change.
There you go.
How's this? I asked you to go get me two bananas and a potato, and you bring me back a dollar and a half of change. I gave you $20.
There's a processing fee.
It's not a process total.
Well,
oh, hey, everybody.
Me.
Steve Spangler, the Spangler Effect, joined always by my good friend, Brian Higginsworth.
Hello.
And so this is kind of how this live event goes. You're wondering if it's live. It's really live. We didn't tape this. We're not trying to trick you. We're not Chris Angel. We're not doing that camera trick thing. This is the real deal, right? So ask me to do something and I'll do it. Raise your hand. See? It's live. So it's a live event. Honestly, this man here is looking at your comments. Tell him it's live so they know.
It is live. I'm reading your comments right now. I'm getting the highs, the hellos. I'm responding back as much as I can. And during this entire time, if you have a question for Steve at all,
don't ask.
Write it on here. Yeah, see? He doesn't want you write it down on here. I'll try and get to it. We'll try and answer it on air. But yeah.
You know what the first question should be is, where is the maybe it's new math. Maybe it's everyday math. Maybe it's, where is my change from the $20 that's outside the dollar and a half?
No one has any idea where that is.
All right. That's how that's gonna go. All right. We are going to do table tricks because it is that time of year that, here's what I like about table tricks, is that you gather for a little holiday feast and you get bored. I mean, you can only hear Uncle Bob's stories for so long and then you want to bust out something. Now, this is unlike, many of you know that I grew up in a family of magicians, and so unlike doing magic tricks at the table, like here, see the knife that's here like this? So you take the knife and you eat the knife. See, that's dumb, because it just hit my leg and it hurt. See, then everybody's trying to one-up each other on magic tricks, but then a lot of people don't know magic tricks. What's cool about doing science tricks is that you just start gathering stuff that's around you. One person says, oh, try this, and another person says, try this. It's pretty easy stuff, and it could be fairly simple. You might be, okay, so you're at a restaurant. Everybody in the world has done this. You're at a restaurant. What's the first thing you do with a straw? I know many of you, because you have not graduated from a mentality of the eighth grade. No, that's me. You pull this off like this, and then this is a perfect little, this is Newton's third law. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. Watch this. See? What says class more to a waitress than you messing around with a straw? Nothing. But then I know what some of you do. You do this kind of thing here, too. So, you, hey, Higgs, we're going to put some water in here. Here, watch this. So you have some water at the table. Because nothing, waitresses like nothing more than for you to mess around at the restaurant. Okay, watch this. Higgs, you're going to be amazed at this, but watch. I'm making worms. Ready? Check this out. Scrunch it down here like this. This is going to be great. There's actually some science here with the paper product, so look at this. All right, here's our little top-down shot. Can you see it there? Oh, this is looking good. So now, see, that's a side, but we're going to top-down. Watch this. I'm going to snap my finger. Top down, see? Okay, now watch this. All right, back to the front, bam. See, watch this. You're right here like this, you touch it with it. Some of you are going, Steve, I've done this a million times. But there is somebody out there in little YouTube land that has never made a straw worm because their parents didn't allow them to do it because they said it would make a mess on the table. Answer, that's true. It does make a mess on the table, but look at this.
I've never done this before in my life.
You are lying.
I promise you, this is great.
When we go to Freddy's, you do this all the time. So. All right, so what are we doing? You're actually scrunching up the paper, and you're bending those fibers, but there's an elasticity that's there, or a memory, right? So as soon as you add that, now all of a sudden those fibers expand once again, and it kind of pushes back out again. If you've ever done that table trick with the toothpicks, this one's a hard one, and you're going to have to go back to Six Science and see some of those, because we do a whole series with toothpicks. This is one where you break the toothpicks in half, you bend them in half, and put them in the plate in such a way that when you add water, that they expand and open up and create a star. Same kind of thing here. You're just getting the wood wet. In this particular, you're getting the paper fiber or the pulp wet, right? And allowing it to be able to expand once again. But that's not all that we're doing. There's far greater things to do. In order to do that, you're going to need some soda, all right? Hey, Higgs, this is where you come in. Do you have anything that you need to talk about, or are you good?
Yeah, actually, one quick thing before you get started with this. I have a question that what inspired you to be doing what you're doing today?
Higginsworth. When I was a little kid, Higginsworth was my teacher in school. No, well, my mom and dad, of course, because my dad is a scientist and did cool magic and all those other things that go along with it. Great teachers in school. High school chemistry teacher that we've had on The Spangler Effect, his name's Doug Hodes. And so if you haven't seen some of the episodes with Doug Hodes, well, I think we should probably bring him back for one of our live events because he's unpredictable and I'm not sure I want to put him on live YouTube, but we know that. But just great teachers and books, and of course Mr. Wizard. When I was growing up, it was Mr. Wizard, and Mr. Wizard's real name is Don Herbert. Some of you have no clue what that means, but his name is Don Herbert. I got a chance to work with him in the late 1990s, and my wife and I actually got lost with Mr. Wizard in a rental car driving the Merritt Parkway in Connecticut. He was getting an honorary doctorate and I got to speak at the event and I got lost with him and I'm driving around Connecticut and he couldn't really hear and his wife's in the back with my wife and they're talking and it was very surreal, but I got to drive around Mr. Wizard. How cool is that? Higgins, no more questions right now. I want you to look at the audience, say I'm Higginsworth.
I'm Higginsworth.
This is a can of soda.
This is a can of soda.
Do you say soda or pop? What do you say?
I kind of mix it up, but more often than not, I say pop.
A pop.
Yeah.
It's actually soda. Yeah. And look it right in the and say, I will open this and not spill a drop.
I will open this and not spill a drop.
You can trust me.
You can trust me.
Good job. All right. So this is a great table trick. This makes mom and dad so proud, right? Or if you're an adult watching this, this is the universal sign to a kid that you are cool. Because if you just peel one of these off when a kid's parent's not watching and you make eye contact, you go like this. The kid's gonna go, that's awesome. And because you know what's gonna happen. Now there are some of you out there in YouTube land that have never, ever shaken a can like this, bam, popped it open and had it explode everywhere. Why? I don't know why. I mean, why would you not do that? Because somebody didn't let you have that experience. You know it's going to explode, right? So this is what we call previous knowledge. I know what's gonna happen. I don't have to make a hypothesis. The question is, why does it happen? So I want you to bust this can open, okay? Remembering that's your computer and it's rented, all right? It's not yours to take. Okay, so what's gonna happen? You know what's gonna happen.
Yeah, it's gonna go everywhere.
It's gonna explode. And if you were to look at what's going on here and we were to pour the soda into the glass, in fact.
There's a cup right there.
Yeah, here's a cup. Here, let me try this. Let's see if there's just enough with this. Ah, this is cream soda. That's perfect. All right, so here we go. Thank goodness this wasn't shaken. All right, here, take a look at this from the side. Would you do that? When you pour this like this, notice the bubbles that are hooking onto the sides right here. See these bubbles that are there? That's bad for the overall explosion of a can because these bubbles hook onto imperfections on the cup or the glass or whatever you have. They're called nucleation points. It's the same reason why when you drop Mentos into Diet Coke, the Diet Coke will go everywhere because the carbonation that's dissolved comes out. These bubbles right now that we shook up this can are at the same place. Now, unlike this, the can is under pressure. So if you pop it open now, the bubbles get big, right? Because as you release the pressure, you increase the volume, and it pushes the soda out. If you want this to not explode, you gotta get all the bubbles off the side. Well, we don't have to worry about it here with the glass because it's not under pressure. But Higginsworth, you now should be able to open up, if you've learned anything at all, this can. You shouldn't open this up for a week, all right? Have you seen people do this before? This does nothing.
That's what I was just going
to
do.
Does nothing. And if you want to just prove to yourself, just take this out after our little show and get a new one and shake it up and go outside with all your little friends and then tap like this and then it's going to go everywhere, right? So what are you going to do?
Tap the sides?
Snap the sides. So watch this. Ready? Snap the sides. Yes, that's good. Look at this. Now the good thing about this is that you don't know when all the bubbles are at the top. The bad thing is, Higgins is opening it. The good thing is, I'm not. So I think, tap a lot. You're done, all right? So here, let me get a glass. Ah, this will be perfect. Ready? So, you should protect the computer. 3, 2, I love the sound. Would you look at this? Bubbles are still there. The ultimate quick table trick. And that's kind of a fun thing to be able to do. Now, I can just hear the applause coming through the computer right now for you, Higgins. Yeah. They love you.
It's chaotic over here.
It is chaotic. All right, so let me tell you something. My wife's husband is an idiot. He did this one time at a party using a diet beverage. So let's just say you were using Diet Coke. don't really know why this is true, but if you take a can of Diet Coke and you shake up a can of Diet Coke like this, and then you're smart and you go, oh, watch me, I'm the science guy, and you do this and you smack it around like this, unfortunately, the bubbles, instead of going to the top, because it's diet, and we think it's because of the aspartame or phenylalanine or whatever it is, really just move themselves over to the side here, which is bad, but you can't see that. And idiot child can't figure it out. So when I bust this thing open here, of course, I mean my wife's husband, of course, goes all over the place. And there's a lot of explaining to do. So do not do this with a diet beverage. In fact, I like to do it with like a sparkling water or a 7-Up or one of those so that if it does explode, and sometimes it will, that at least you're kind of covered. Fair enough? We're playing more soda. All right, so we have soda. So why don't we play a little soda game that is kind of fun. Now, it's all in the presentation, right? So look at this. I have this aquarium. You don't have to do this. So just because we're calling it table tricks doesn't mean that you can't run to the sink and fill up the sink with water or whatever, or bathtub is perfect. So you just fill up the bathtub with water, is whatever, and then you go get every can of soda you can find in the house. You're looking for as many different cans of soda as possible because we want to come up with some sort of pattern that's here, right? Do you ever have that thing when you're a kid when you go to the pool and somebody there at the pool or mom and dad would take the cans of soda like on 4th of July for the big festivities? Did your mom and dad ever take you to the pool?
Yeah.
No, they didn't. and then they take the cans and they throw them in the pool and then you have to dive down to the bottom to retrieve your cans. That was cool.
I'm not a very good swimmer. I never did that.
I understand. There were some cans that mom and dad didn't realize behaved a little bit differently. For example, let's say we take the regular Coke, and the regular Coke goes inside. It is no wonder that the Coke sinks, because that's exactly what happened to the swimming pool. And here's another can of Coke, just a little older. Yep, good. How about Pepsi? Are we good there? So that's perfect. And here's Diet Coke. That's the same. And here's the sparkling water. That's the same. And here is, hang on a second. Must have a little bubble here. These have bubbles in them, so here, hold on a second. There you go. So now you, okay, maybe lemon. Okay, you know what? Get one of these Cokes out because nobody cares about the Coke, actually. And we want lemonade. That's pretty good for you. And we want, noops. All right, see the pattern? See what we're looking at here? Difference between float and sink. Now, if you know the difference and why it does the float and sink, that's great, but ask people, don't tell them right away. Part of this that we want to do is we want to go, oh, I'm going to tell you why, and then they reveal the secret. I think it's kind of fun with this kind of thing to see if you can build a pattern and just say, well, what if we tried this, or what if we tried Arizona iced tea, or what if we tried something else, and to do the float sink and come to some sort of comparison. I was doing this with a group of fourth graders years ago, and we're walking around the room, and we had buckets, and we put all these down in buckets, and I'm hoping that they would see a pattern. I want these fourth graders to go, oh, Mr. Spangler, this is great. Look at this. All of these, I'm going to categorize over here, float, and all of these over here, sink, and now they come up with some sort of wonderful hypothesis about why these float and these sink, and the answer with these fourth graders was as follows, Mr. Spangler, you got gypped. You see, there's not as much soda in these cans that floated as these are that sink. And you go, no. See, it's exactly the same. Look at this. Can I show you here? Where is it? It's right there on our camera. 355 milliliters. Do you see that? 355 milliliters. This Coke right over here, same kind of thing. 312 ounces or 355 milliliters. Still, they thought that there was a little bit more in this can. So here I am trying to pop both of them open, find two equal glasses, trying to pour them in, when I don't want them to think that anyway. And one of the girls who was very smart looked at it and she said, ah, Mr. Spangler, I've got it. The answer is right there. This particular Coke has, what is it, 140 calories, is that right? Yes, 140 calories, and the diet has no calories, therefore this sinks and the diet floats. And the answer, kids, is this: calories don't weigh anything. You might not think that at the holidays, mom and dad would say, but calories don't weigh anything. You have to look, keep on looking down. The only difference here is that this Coke has 39 grams of sugar, and this has 0 grams of sugar. No wonder one floats and one sinks. So if the volume is the same, correct? It's the same amount of soda, the can size is the same. The only thing that could be is the amount of dissolved stuff that's in the can, and that's why we have this floating going on. It's no wonder that this sparkling water that we used before floats, because there's no sugar in there. But I think here's the real kicker. How much sugar is 39 grams? If we ask most Americans, how much sugar is 39 grams, your life depends on it. You gotta put about 39 grams of sugar in my hand. Most of us couldn't do that. This is why they write 39 grams on the side of the can, because we as Americans don't get that because we didn't switch over to the old metric system. So we have to kind of, Higginsworth, we kind of have to show them what 39 grams is all about. All right? So take a look at this. I have some sugar here for us so we can see some of the differences that are there. So how much is 39 grams? Now it's not an exact kind of thing. So you just have to know that it's a basic representation. It's not exact, but here's what it looks like. Hold out your hand, Higgs. I went to the local 7-Eleven. You know how you get your coffee in the morning?
Yeah.
And I just needed all these sugars for my coffee. Or at least that's what I told the attendant. So I'm going to put them in your hand. You tell me when to stop when we get to 39. And I'll give you a hint. I'm going to start at 4. So getting pretty close. Ready? So 4 of them.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go. 5. Any more?
Yeah, keep going.
Oh, wow. 6, 7, 8. You want to take one away?
Let's...
9.
Okay. One more.
10. One more. Is that what your guess is?
I think
I'm
10. I'm going
to give you 2 more. 11, 12. How about 13, 14, 15, 16,
what?
17, 18, nearly 18 packets of sugar in the can of Coke. It's no wonder when you drink the stuff, you have to exercise. Or,
yeah,
you see how it is. So there's now, look at this. If you were to this piece here, let's say like the diet uses Splenda, for example, they might only use one packet of Splenda. So see the comparison here? One packet of Splenda here or 18 of these here. This still doesn't mean that this is good, right? So you're going to deal with an issue later on in life with this, or you're going to have to exercise with this. There's a clear alternative, water. Water's not bad. It's kind of a good thing, but you understand the difference between floating and sinking. And there are many variations online, so you're gonna find some crazy cans that are out there now that will float and will sink in different ways that that makes it kind of fun. And I gotta show you a trick. I'm gonna pull this back here for a second because I gotta show you something else with this. But watch this. If you wanna mess with somebody, sometimes you can do this. See the little indentation that's right here? See this little indentation right there? See the little curve? All right, this will trap a bubble every once in a while. So watch this. If you put it straight down like this, sometimes you can make the can of Coke look like it floats. See that? See, it's floating. So you do the floating Coke trick, and somebody goes, how in the world did you make the Coke float? Well, you're just completely cheating because there's a bubble underneath, and now all of a sudden it'll sink. So you see? It's all about messing with somebody else. That's kind of how it works. But this leads you into a wonderful discussion about sugar and those things. And that's why this next little part is kind of fun. Questions, Higgins?
Yes. One right off the bat is, Higginsworth, how many times has Steve made you cry?
Never. Now, of course.
Of course not.
Duh. So never. Are you okay?
Yeah.
Your counselor is a nice person, I think.
The best.
Yes. Yeah. All right.
The other question, let's see. What do we got on here? So are your kids into science as much as you are?
My kids are into science as much as I am. They're just, they have resources that I didn't have. And so, you know, they used to come to you and go, hey, Dad, what's the planet that, don't worry about it, I'll go to Google. And so I think that my position as a dad, as the guy who knew stuff, you know, it's just like, well, they go to Google. So I had to change my perspective as a dad. And when my kid says, so Triton is a moon on Neptune, I have to sit there and wonder, what is this kid? Who stole my kid in the first place? But how did this kid think of Triton and Neptune? And so what are you thinking about? And what he was really thinking about was liquid nitrogen, because his teacher had done a show about liquid nitrogen and solid, liquid, and gaseous state is on the moon Triton. Isn't that kind of cool?
They come to you
and they ask you. So it's my job to kind of push back a little bit. But there's so many opportunities for kids today. They're a little bit different than what we had before that we have to kind of shift our way of thinking. You know, when you're talking about this, you want to be very, very careful. Can I show you this? See the little packet here of Splenda or the NutraSweet? See the pink, the sweet and low or whatever? You got to be really, really careful about eating this stuff here because this here, you have to be careful because this can harden your arteries. So here, let me pour some out in here. And then I think I have a little bit of water. Yeah, here, watch this. Ready? So here we go. three, two, one. That's good. And then, so you have to be really, really careful because this will harden your arteries. So eating this will make you feel more full, Higgins, right? So don't worry about this, but that's just what happens. I think we're messing with them now. I think there's some of them are going, whoa. And then there's teachers out there going, kids, we have to deprogram you. Do not listen to Mr. Spangler because I messed with you. That's exactly what I did.
Turning it off right away.
Yeah, these aren't real, right? But isn't that kind of fun? If you're going to do table tricks, then do a trick. And so this is kind of cool. Here's what I did. These packets here, I cut open. Well, truth be told, Higginsworth cut them open because he does it better than I do. And we took out the sweet and low, but we put some of the water gel material. You know the super absorbent material that's in a baby's diaper? That powder there is a super absorbent polymer. It's called sodium polyacrylate. And so it's always in my control. If I'm playing the joke, I only have this one. And so now I can open it up and it looks like it's real. Pour this down inside. And then when you add the water, it's super absorbent. It absorbs 300 to 500 times its weight in water. Very, very quickly. Higgins, hold this over your head. Turn it upside down. Go. See, you did a good job.
I probably should have looked at that a little clearer.
Yeah,
but
you did. You just kind of threw it over your head.
Yep.
So if you're going to mess with people, this is a good way to be able to do it. Don't get yourself in trouble, but I understand. Okay? Super absorbent polymers and a cool way to be able to introduce it. All right. I got to show you an optical illusion that's kind of cool. So it starts this way. It's not a table trick from the very beginning, but then you've just got to change it up. All right. So I cut two of these out of a piece of cardboard. All right. So and colored them. This one's yellow. I don't know what to call it. It's an arc, maybe an arc. There's a yellow arc and there's a red arc. And the red arc is smaller than the yellow arc. You can tell that because when I put the ends here like this and measure it, it's a good about 8 centimeters smaller. So you just have to remember the yellow one is bigger than the red one. No matter if it's this way or this way, the yellow one is bigger than the red one. Now, the thing is, this is made out of a special kind of cardboard. I don't know if you've seen it before in boxes, but if you try to put all your stuff, you know, when your mom said, get out of the house, when she said, and you had to have the boxes, do you remember the boxes?
Yeah, I do.
You can do this. You can stretch the cardboard. So now the red one is bigger than the yellow one. See how this works? So the red, no, maybe top down. Maybe look at it this way. Here we go. The red one is bigger than the yellow one. Or is the yellow one bigger than the red one? Wait, that's a little strange. The red one is truly smaller than the yellow one, or is that the yellow one is truly, that, isn't that crazy? It's a totally cool optical illusion, and I gotta show you how it works. First of all, you can cut this out of a dinner plate. So if you take a, not a glass one, you know what I mean, a paper one, and you cut the edge out and cut the center out and clip it, and you can get a nice little arc. You can also go to your fancy little Starbucks and find one of those sleeves, you know, the sleeves they put around the coffee. If you open that up and lay it out, it kind of works pretty well as an arc. They're both exactly the same size. So you need to know that, first of all, the trick is this. You've got to have them exactly the same size. However, when you separate them and you put one on top of the other one, it truly looks like the bottom one is bigger than the top one. Again, from a top down, look at exactly what we're doing here. You're actually comparing things that are unequal. And I think this is important to know as a science skill. Look at this. Your eye compares this short arc to the longer arc here. And as soon as you make the comparison, it looks like this one is bigger than this one, when in fact, one on top of the other, they're exactly the same. But if you don't do it that way and you put it out there, look at that. It really looks like yellow one's bigger than the red, or the red one is bigger than the yellow. So this is fun now to turn it into a table trick. Remember that thing I did with Higgins where I went like this, yellow one is bigger than the red one, and then I said, but you can stretch it like this, and now the red one is bigger than the yellow one. See how that works?
That's cool.
You could do the same thing with bananas. So the next time you're in the supermarket, you just, and there's kids close by, you just have to say, see, you try to compare them like this, you go, oh, this is perfect. And the produce person or a kid will walk by and go, what are you doing? You say, you know what I always do? I always buy the smaller bananas, like this top one's the smaller one, and then you just stretch it, and it actually is bigger. See how that kind of works? So you buy the small ones, stretch them, they're bigger.
You do that all the time?
Well, I got kicked out of that one down the way and then that other one. So no, I don't get to do that anymore. But it was fun when I did do it. It was. But Higgins, for you, always buy the smaller bananas, give a little stretch, and the bigger one is here because it is a cool optical illusion. Isn't that kind of fun?
That is
a stretching banana trick. Okay. Man. All right. There are more fun things to show you. You know, we had straws before. So, oh, you know what? Let me tell them about this. There has to be some sort of benefit for you watching our live event. And first of all, thanks to our YouTube sponsors for allowing us to be able to do this. A lot of people ask, is this your studio? Is this a home? This is our, we call it our playroom. We have a kitchen kind of setting, but it's a working kitchen. Like if Higgins goes over there, is there a wide shot? See this one over here? See, go open up the refrigerator. It's real. So the people who kind of work here, yep, there it is. So the people who work here use this as a kitchen. So when we do a live YouTube event or a Spangler Effect, we have to shut this down. And what you don't see out there are, you know, signs saying we're doing a live taping. So this is where we hang out and play. And this is kind of what we do. But we want there to be a reason for you to watch. And so one of the things that we wanted to offer you was this. These are the two books that we did about 2 years ago. First one was a book called Naked Eggs and Flying Potatoes, and another one is called Fire Bubbles and Exploding Toothpaste. And these are a special now, so if you're going to give a gift to a teacher or you're looking for some cool science experiments, there's about 30 science experiments in each one of the books. Everything from eating nails for breakfast to how to use taco sauce to clean pennies, density column. This entire thing is nothing but a big table trick, and who in the world doesn't want to make a folding egg? Everybody wants to do that, or a naked egg, either one of those. Each one has about 35 activities. Normally they're $15 a piece. We have a special discount code that if you order more than $50 worth of product on our website, then we give you both the books for free. So it's a $30 value that we give to you. There's a special code for you, and so that code is B-O-O-K-S for you. So it's B-O-O-K-S for you. Add everything to your cart, use the discount code, these will come off. If you just have any questions, just call the 800 number, 1-800-223-9080. 1-800-223-9080, or go online. But we at least wanted to let you know that all the table tricks that we're talking about today, plus about 69 more, are sitting in there, okay? All right, let's go back to the straws. Look at this. I had a kindergarten teacher, her name was Mrs. Carden, and I remember when Mrs. Carden came in, she said, boys and girls, today, we are making porcupines. Now notice Higginsworth, she didn't say, today we're doing a science experiment. She said, today we are making a porcupine.
That sounds awesome.
It is awesome, because she was an awesome kindergarten teacher. But she was doing a science experiment, little did we know. And boys are much different than girls when it comes to this kind of thing, because boys, well, here's what she said. Take the straws, and she had a pile of straws, and she had a bunch of potatoes, and she said, jam the straws through the potato, bring it to me, I'll put these eyes on it. You know, she had these little googly eyes, and that was supposed to be our porcupine to take home.
Cool.
Little did we realize that within seconds of her saying that, she's got every boy going, grr! You cannot put a straw through a potato because it just crushes the straw like this. Does not work. You plug a little straw or whatever it is, but it's just flimsy. How Kathy Denton knew how to do this, I have no idea, but she did. And so when the entourage of girls show up in kindergarten, because they always work their way in an entourage nowadays, here's what Kathy Denton knew what to do. Look at this, I'm gonna show you up close. She put her thumb on the end of the straw. If you put your thumb on the end of the straw like this, you think that there's nothing in the straw. There is, it's air. Air occupies space, has weight, exerts pressure. This is good stuff. So now watch this. I think Carden got to the girls and said, this is how we're gonna mess with the boys, and they taught them how to do this, right? Just so that we'd look at it and
I
go,
can see that.
We are just not smart. So watch what you do. You put your thumb on the end of the straw, and so now you've gotta, and I gotta look right at the camera and tell you this. Brown is the potato, pink is me. If I forget that, we are gonna go to camera bars and tone, and it'll go to black. Got it? I will not forget this. I will jam down like this, and if you follow through, Higginsworth, you can actually put the straw through the potato. Watch this. Now tell me that's not cool. See this little piece right here? Ah, perfect. All right, so if you get a little piece of potato here, you don't want to waste the straw, you do this again. Hup. Oh, did you hear that pop? This is what happens when you have a cheap straw. All right, so now I had an exploding straw at the same time. Ah, but now take a look at this. Pretend like there was no explosion right there, because now guess what happens? You have a piece of potato here, you have a piece of potato here, and you have air trapped here. Okay? If you jam down one more time really hard, it pushes this piece of potato up, squeezes the molecules of air, and fires this at your head at about 30 miles an hour. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a little tiny potato gun. A launcher. Potato launcher. It's 2013, kids. It's a potato launcher. The problem is, They're making straws a little cheaper than they used to. So Higginsworth, I got to show you, this is totally fun.
What
get
is
yourself
that?
A bigger straw. It's not a problem. Don't worry about it. So this is just a bigger straw. Went to the hardware store, got a little bigger straw. So now you just carve out a little piece like this, which is perfect. Now you need a plunger. Go to aisle 17 of the plunger store and get the plunger, all right? So this is, kids, don't try this at home. Try it at a friend's home. Because their dad and mom may have some of this extruded plastic, and this would be a tremendous amount of fun. Isn't that, hey Higgs, how was that?
Was that really
pretty
awesome.
Good? Is that great? Did you increase, there's a little, did you know, kids, this goes through drywall? So that is a little potato launcher right there, page 34 in the old book, and that's kind of how that works. Higgs, ask me a question because I'm going to clean up this mess.
All right. I like this one that came through. How many licks does it take to get to the Tootsie Roll center of a Tootsie Pop?
3.14162924.
Bam.
So, thank
and
you.
And Higginsworth and Steve, what are your favorite movies?
My favorite movies.
Yeah.
See, now I don't know how to answer that because I don't know who our audience is. There might be a movie that is a movie that might be funny but not appropriate, you know, like a PG-13 or something like that.
Appropriate for sure.
Appropriate for sure. Mm-hmm. What's yours?
Mine, either Dumb and Dumber, Braveheart.
Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say a documentary of some kind. No, I
something
yes, exactly.
You know,
this is exactly what we're talking about. Let me think through that and see if there's one. You know what I love is Christmas Vacation. Every year with my kids, we always sit down and watch Christmas Vacation. We've got all the lines memorized. It's just a great time.
Yep.
I don't know. That's how that works. Thanks for your science-related questions. Really appreciate those. We are moving on. Take a look at this over here. It's time for bottle tricks. So, you are going to need some root beer bottles. So, see the little root beer bottles that are here? The root beer bottles, that's kind of cool. Now, you can use these crush bottles as well, so that's fine. So, either one of these will be just fine, but we're going to need to have a nice little selection of bottles. We get to the portion of the show that we call, I'll bet you I can win some money from you. So that's what we call this. This is how you increase your college fund, okay?
Yes.
And the next thing is this. You are going to be a supplier of the bottle, so just make sure that you're having a little dinner where you have some bottles of root beer. And then you're going to have to say, does anybody in the, this is the technique that's always good. Does anybody have a dollar bill I can borrow? That's a really good thing to say. So does anybody have a dollar bill I can borrow? This is perfect. All right, so we're going to do some demos with the dollar bill. Here's a great challenge. All right, so you put the dollar bill here like this. You take the bottle, you turn it upside down, you put it here like this. I like that. And now the object is this. Is our top down? Am I kind of right in the right position for our good little camera there? Oh, look at this. You can see exactly what it looks like. All right, so here is the challenge. The challenge is you've got to get the dollar bill out from underneath the bottle without touching the bottle or allowing the bottle to knock over. I know what you're thinking, it's the old tablecloth trick, but watch this. When you try the tablecloth trick, does not always work. So that's not the way to do it, all right? You've got to get the dollar bill out from underneath the bottle. And you got to use a little science as well, all right? I'm going to let you think at home. How much more time do we have for the show? How long should I let them think?
5-10 seconds.
Okay, you got your answer? Bingo. The one technique might be this. What we're gonna try to do is there's inertia with the bottle, right? The tendency of an object to stay at rest until force acts upon it. If we pull the dollar bill out this way, this is a sideways force and I can't really get it out because it's precariously placed. So what I'm gonna do is this. I'm gonna take the dollar bill and I'm gonna roll it up like this and I'm not gonna touch the bottle with my hands, but look at what I'm doing. I'm pushing the bottle away, pushing the bottle away. Oh, don't fall. Push the bottle away. Look at this, look at this, look at this. Without touching the bottle, look at that. I got the dollar bill out, and guess what? My college fund is a dollar better than it was before. Not a bad way to do it, all right? So simple way, thank goodness there's not a lot of friction, and that works pretty well, all right? So. Here, try this one. This is kind of fun. I shouldn't have ruined the dollar bill early on. You want it kind of crisp for this. Try this. The change that Higginsworth brought back from the great things that he went and bought. All right, so here are the quarters. All right, so you want to be able to get the quarters. Try this. The quarters are resting on top of the bottle like that. Got it? Let me see if I can just show you a side angle as well so you can kind of see what that looks like. See, the quarters are resting on the bottle there. So the object is for you to get the dollar bill out from underneath the quarter without knocking over the bottle, touching the bottle, or touching the quarters. Okay, now you might be able to use the tablecloth trick, right? Because the quarters have inertia. They want to stay there until a force acts upon it. And because they're not as precariously perched as they were before, you might be able to take it here like this and kind of pull it out this way. Look at that. Not bad. But it wasn't as dramatic. So let's find a better way to do it, all right? And if you want to, here's a little something that I suggest. The fewer the quarters, the harder it is to do, because it doesn't have mass. So when I try to pull it out this way, you can kind of see that it's a little bit tougher to do as I try to pull it off. So you want to increase the mass. So here, take a look at this. There are some more quarters here. We just do a nice stack of quarters, so this should be good. All right, so this now, the whole thing goes on top here like this. Got it? So now we want to get the quarters out from underneath the we want to get the dollar bill out from underneath the quarters. Okay, watch this, ready? You take your finger like this and you're gonna karate chop the dollar bill. So see how the dollar bill is curved just a little bit like this? So now we're gonna karate chop it. See if we can keep it there. Watch this, 1, 2, 3.
Yeah!
Oh, wait, you scared me, Higgs. Okay, yeah, she's yell yeah. All right, you ready? Here we go, get ready with your yeah, do it better. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. Oh, I did, I caught it, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Yeah!
That's it, that's what I was looking for. See, it looked pretty good.
That was awesome.
Yeah, that was pretty good. So what a cool way to be able to kind of pull it out that fast. And again, we're trying to use a little bit of Newton's first law. Tendency of an object to stay at rest until a force acts upon it. And now you can use every variation of this possible. So here, let me try it again. Let me see if I can get this guy out on the first one, right? Yes, that's what I wanted you to see. All right, so do the same thing. Wow. Just got yourself some quarters. That's not a bad way to do it. How about this? If you're careful, this goes here. Try this, Higgs. This could be a disaster on a granite countertop. This might not be a really smart idea. Okay? Oh, stay there. Okay, so now let's see if we can try to snap this out like we had before. I just want it so that it's resting out just a little bit. Ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Look at that, we did it. Never once awesome. In practice has it worked. Got it, all right? So there are a ton of cool bottle tricks that you can do. Try this one, I think that you'll like this one as well. You're gonna need a glass of water. Higgins, do you have a glass for some water?
Right here.
Glass of water, oh, that's perfect. All right, so here's what you're gonna have in front of you. Gotta get everybody to eliminate their knives. We are going to have, let's do these bottles here so it's clear, so you can kind of see what's going on. So we'll take the brown one, set them off to the side. All right, so the reason you need the knives is that these bottles need to be about a knife space away. So that's how we're just gonna kind of measure it out here like this. Knife space away, that's perfect. All right, here's what you need to do. Using these knives, you need to put these knives on the bottle in such a way that you can rest this glass in the very center of the knives. Now, you'll notice that this does not work. See this? That doesn't work. So the bottles have to be far away from each other, about a knife lengths away, and you've got to find some way to be able to rest the glass right here like this. Got it? Now, to add more fun to it, you dump the water first. So I'm gonna dump the water out so it doesn't seem like it's a big deal. But, not to belabor the point, this is one of those things you're just gonna have to practice and play with. So here's what we're gonna do. I always think of it like this. If you look at a top-down version, in my brain, I have to think that each one of these is the support. So this open end of the knife is gonna be in between these bottles. Another open end of the knife will be between these bottles, and the last one will be between these bottles. See how it's gonna go? So if I do this and this, okay, so here, I'll stretch these back out again. So I know I'm gonna have here, here, like that. And so now I'm gonna have to come in between here and see if I can hook this. All right, so this is sometimes easier said than done. And I will tell you that Bradley in the control room right now is just going, Steve, I hope you can get this. Please get this so it doesn't take like hours for us to do this segment. All right, so here, here, oh, that's what I need to do is I'm gonna go up and under this way, okay? So I've got it here. And here and here. All right, so here we go. Higgins, it's going to be good, I think. I think I'm going to get it. I'm not sure. Look at that.
Solid.
Yeah, you were kind of worried, weren't you? You thought the rest of the show was going to be me doing this. All right? All right, so look at this. So see the little network that we have? Now let's see if it'll support the glass. We have a studio audience right now, and they are taking bets as to whether or not... All right. Oh, I'll stay there. Stay there. Good. We've got it. And now, Higgs, what's going to happen next? Here we go. This is going to be good. Ready? Dun, 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 dun. This is going to be great. Look at this glass of water resting on the top. Look at some of the cool engineering that goes along with this. We don't say the word STEM all that time because I know that if you're in school, you're hearing it all the time and talking about it. But look at exactly what we're having to do. We had to use a little bit of science, understanding how this is going to balance, and we have to have support. I don't have any technology, actually. I could say it's the knives. It's just you on the computer. All right? But the engineering is cool because, look, we've now weaved back and forth, so it's holding in place right there. And I think it's not so bad.
It's pretty cool.
And I know somebody's saying, well, what are you using for M for math? I don't know. That's the problem. I can't turn everything into a full STEM activity, all right? But you see that we're kind of incorporating a couple
knives.
Of those. Oh.
Yeah.
Bam! Blew my head off right there. That was amazing.
I know. Right. You're welcome.
We're going to come back to this here in just a second, all right? But that's our balancing glass of water and our kind of our cool bottle trick, okay? All right, Higgs, this little area here might get a little bit more messy, so if there's any questions you have for me, we might want to talk about those. And while you're looking through those, let me just tell you, there's no way on the short time that we have to get through a whole bunch of all the table tricks that are in the repertoire. So if you visit stevespanglerscience.com, you'll visit the lab. We have experiments. Of course, all of our YouTube videos are included there as well. All the six science videos, all those things that are there, hopefully there'll be a resource for you. I got to give you a couple challenges while Higginsworth is thinking about that, because I have something over here for you as well. Higgins, any questions?
I just want to give a lot of shout outs. I won't get you all, but Justice Johnson, Katie Myers, Jen Garrett, Zaid Arshad, MZ1, who said multiple times, 17-year-old, inspired
like
by
How
us,
cool.
Loves you, mainly.
No, this is the deal that's here.
Yeah, and then one of the questions that popped up was, right there. It was, who is always talking to you when you come out from backstage of the Ellen Show? So you always come out from backstage and you're always talking to someone, and they wanted to know who was talking to you and if Ellen talked to you during the break.
The nice lady who talks to me backstage, her name is Roxy or Roxanne, and she's been the stage manager for the last 7 years that we've been there, and she always says something to you right before you go out, and I always talk to her, and so she always says something to me, and I just turn and I talk to her for a second and didn't realize that that's what I was doing until my wife said, who are you talking to? I go, I'm talking to Roxanne back there. And so that's who I'm talking to. And yes, Ellen does. She's very, very nice during the breaks. And she engages and talks a lot. And she's just a very classy lady. So it's the whole crew there is very cool.
Awesome.
This is a great transition to wine. All right. So kids, mom and dad at the holidays may have an extra bottle of wine. What you're going to do is this. You are going to save the cork. The little cork that's here, because notice there is nothing inside the bottle except for air, but we've taken the cork and jammed the cork down inside. So you see what that looks like? I took a piece of dowel rod here, put it in there. It doesn't go down very easily, so you have to take a hammer or something like that and try, oops, easier than I thought. That's a good thing. All right, so in fact, let's use this one because that seems like a pretty good one to use. The object is this. You need to get the cork out of the bottle, but you can't. I'm sorry, I'm looking right there. See that? Bam, we were going back and forth. I'll get these out of the way. You need to get the cork out of the bottle, but you can't break the bottle, and you can't destroy the cork. Good challenge, I think. You want to get the cork out of the bottle, but you can't break the bottle, you can't destroy the cork. You got to pull the cork out in its entirety, and the bottle has to stay intact. Now, if you are a fan of the Spangler Effect, you know that with my good friend Doug Hodes, we have done the opposite of the egg in the bottle. It was the egg coming out of the bottle. You remember when he stood here and went, Remember that whole thing?
Yeah.
All right, so we could. Yes, I do. Yes, it is liquid nitrogen. So we don't want to put liquid nitrogen in this bottle because this is not tempered glass, and it's not like the Pyrex that we use, right? Or the borsalite glass. So if you could somehow put some pressure inside there and put that in there, it would push it out. So I like the way that you would think that way. Try this. The way it's written up in these old science books, and I collect these old science magic books from a long time ago, and I've got a great library of them, the gentleman would reach into his pocket and get his hanky and jam the hanky down inside and then turn this upside down and somehow capture this with a hanky and try to pull it back out again. Well, it's 2013 and most people don't have hankies. If they do, be concerned. So what I'd like to have you do is this. You use that paper or that plastic bag from the store. So here's the plastic bag from the store. Pay attention, Higgins, you're gonna have to do this, okay? So here's what you do. You take this and you kind of wad it up like this, okay? This goes down inside here, so you kind of push it down inside like this. Got it? Now try to get as much of it down inside as you can. Good. Now we're gonna try to inflate it just a little bit in there. See if we can throw a little air into it. So now watch, see if you can catch. Can I show you the top down, what that looks like? Try to catch the cork right there on the edge. So you see how it's kind of opened up a little bit? We're just gonna try to catch it here, okay? And then you're just gonna try to pull it out. So see how you've got it on the bottle here, the neck?
Yeah.
All right, so I don't know. Sometimes I do not do well with this. All right, here we go, here we go. Oh, do you look at that, look. Bingo. Oh,
sweet.
Isn't that kind of fun?
That was
cool.
It's
an easy way to get it out. Now, it doesn't always happen that way. Sometimes they're a little bit tougher than others. Like here, this one. Try this one, Higgins. You can just do that while I set up something else.
All right.
Okay? We have created a mess. All right. Now, you know what the other thing you could do is this. To make this interactive, if you have a cool table trick, there's one of two things that you can do. You can either post it on the channel as a video, if that's something you want to do, or maybe in the comments, tell us about the trick that you have, and maybe you've already posted online on your YouTube channel, and put the link for us so that we can see it that way as well, which might make it kind of fun. Okay? Well, did you get it out, Higgins?
I'm working on it.
Okay, it's going to go. You're going to do a good job. Oh, Higgs, look at this.
Uh-oh.
It's going to just pull hard. Ready? Oh, I'm sorry. That wasn't a very good job. But you can play with that when we're all done with the show, okay? Because I have something else for you that will be even more fun. Let's say you have a bottle of Diet Coke. And let's just say for the sake of argument that you have six friends. Do you have six friends?
More or less.
Good. And you want to serve them the Coke. And you wanted to serve them the Coke all at the same time.
Get because, 6 2-liters.
No, you're not going to go out and get 6 2-liters. That's where my money went when I gave you the extra money. So what are you going to do to try to serve all these people the Coke at the same time? Answer, Mentos. So what we're going to do is this. We are going to drop the Mentos into the Coke. And then and you know that because from the very beginning, we talked a little bit about nucleation points.
Yep.
The Mentos are going to go down into the Coke. When the Mentos go down into the Coke, the nucleation points, the pits that are on the Mentos are going to shoot the Coke back out again. So the carbon dioxide is going to, of course, come out. That's going to shoot the liquid out. And then it's going to come into these six glasses.
So we're going to collect it from the ceiling.
No. It's going to go right. You're not going to get anything on the ceiling. Got it? Well, there are a couple more things that you're going to need. So the next thing you're going to need is this. I had a toy as a kid called a tornado tube. So let me just show you how I built this. So this is a tornado tube. Let me show you what this looks like here. Here's our tornado tube. Got it? Notice that I've hollowed this part out. Maybe I'll go to our late night cam over here. See this? See how it's hollowed out there? Perfect. This side is not. So again, this is just time at the hardware store trying to find things that would fit together. Okay? I want the Mentos to be in here and put this on top, and then when we pull, but I can't have a pin because I don't want this flying all over the place. So that's where the next part comes in. Let me show you the camera here. We have a very strong magnet. This is a neodymium magnet and a ball bearing. All right, so watch what I'm going to do. I'm going to hold the magnet here like this. I'm going to drop the ball bearing down inside. Bingo. That is what it looks like. So notice that the ball bearing is right there. So the ball bearing is there. That's good because let me set it here and now see if I can show you what it looks like when we load up our Mentos. So we grab our Mentos here. I think 6 or 7 will be just fine. So now look at this. I can load them in the tube like this. Got it. So now there's no pin, there's no string. The only thing that's holding it in place is that magnet. Now I've got a really strong magnet. I told you that's a neodymium magnet, and that's a good thing because it's gonna hold it in place. When you pull the magnet, of course, the ball bearing will fall and all the Mentos will fall inside, okay? So that's where this comes in. Brand new bottle of Diet Coke. Question always comes to me, why do you use Diet Coke? Do you have an endorsement? No, we use Diet Coke and Diet Pepsi for the very first one that we ever did, the one that went viral at the very beginning in September of 2005, because we didn't want to make the Pepsi people mad or the Coke people mad, so we used Pepsi and Coke. And the second thing is, diet doesn't have sugar. Remember this? If diet doesn't have sugar, it means it's not sticky. So diet soda can't be sticky, so for cleanup, it's so much easier. That's the reason why it became Diet Coke and Mentos, okay? All right, so this goes off here like this. This is the scary part, so you know what I need to do? Higgs, let's see if we can take a knife and see if we can take this little thing off here. So I'm gonna pull this guy off, I've got it. All right, no problem at all. This goes here. This is a little scary, Higgs.
Yeah, I'm just gonna move a thing.
No,
or
you're
two.
Fine, you're fine. All right, so this is good. Move that computer out of the way, all right?
Yep.
So here we go, this is good. I think I'm killing the late night cam over here. Okay, so now, if we drop it in, this doesn't help anything because it just shoots up. That's where my son's Super Soda Dispenser 3000 comes into play. Yes, Jack invented the Super Soda Dispenser 3000. So here's what it looks like. You just go to the hardware store, you take about 20 bucks, the same 20 bucks I gave Higginsworth, and you buy the little tees. And then you cut the small little pieces that are here. This is gonna perfectly fit into the top. And these are just pieces, of course, of PVC. So all we did was paint them to make them look a little bit more fun. This goes on top here, like that. Got it? So Higgs, look at how much fun this is gonna be. If you move these over like this, it should be pretty good. You just need to make sure they're coming straight down. Feeling good?
Yeah, let me go get some friends so we can share.
No, you're gonna do this. This is gonna be great, right? So we're gonna pull like this, bam, you're gonna dry it, it's gonna be great. You got it?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
Are you ready?
3, 2, 1, pull, drops in. Oh.
Ah,
see how perfect that is? It didn't spill a drop. That's what's so great about this experiment. It's just doesn't spill any of that soda.
Let me go get people to help drink this.
Yes, go get people. And in fact, why don't you get people and let's make the human table, because I think that we've got to do that. Isn't that kind of fun? So a way to be able to serve 6 people all at once. And kids, remember the rules. Don't try this at home. Try it at a friend's home and everything will be just fine.
Let's talk to 4 people down here about doing the human
table. All right,
table.
Here is what we're going to do. We are going to head over, because you're going to need to get 4 friends. I feel like I'm talking over something. You're going to need to get 4 friends. Let's say you want to do a table trick.
You
have no table. You have nothing to go on the table.
Sorry.
You have no food. Like, you don't have bananas. You have nothing that we worked with today. Of course, there's no Mentos and Diet Coke. What are you going to do? The answer is pretty simple. You're going to get 4 chairs, because
we are live.
You could find in my little altered reality, you could find 4 chairs. Okay? So our chairs are sitting off to the side here. Higginsworth is going to get somebody. As soon as he comes back and has got the 4 people, we're going to head over to the chairs. So, all right, and I see them coming off to the side. Higgins, you have a camera, don't you? So if you'll flip on your camera, we'll walk over here and see if we can find that second round. And everybody is here. So I feel like Mr. Rogers. And we're heading this way. All right, here we go. Da-dum, da-dum. Oh, yeah, there you go, Higgs. Hey, you're over this way. Now this is perfect. Look, this is our chair set up right here. So you see our chairs that we have kind of set up this way. So we have a chair that is here and a chair that is here, which is great, and a chair that's here. And you can see that we have a chair that is over here. So the object here is to kind of get the chairs fairly close together, and then you need to have 4 lovely people. And look at this, da-da, come here, 4 lovely people, look at this. Anne and Danae and Brian and Callie, and they've all said yes to this, which is a wonderful thing. So notice how I'm gonna get people to sit. So for example, Brian, fairly tall. See, if you're trying to do this, you would want them all about the same size, but not me. I'm trying for something harder, all right? Brian, you sit right here with your legs facing that way. Got it, bingo. Danae, you're gonna sit here with your legs facing that way, and you're going to sit here with your legs facing this way. Callie, sit over here with your legs facing this way. All right, So we're not exactly sure. You're going to be a little. Yes, that's probably pretty good. All right, so take a look at this. Kind of get in here and take a look. See where they are. We want to position them. So if I take Callie and I rest Callie back like this, Callie's shoulders are resting on Brian's leg. So you might have to get just a little closer to him, okay? So I'm going to push it. Yes, I think that's going to be great. All right, so watch this. Remember how we did the knives? This is like the human knives. So watch this. Knife number one. I'm going to push you in like this. Here we go. Number two. Good. You okay? Good. All right, Danae, number three. Very nice. All right, Brian, number four. Okay, so look at this. See? This is like human knives right here. So now here's what we're going to do. You just have to see the angle that they have of their legs. You just now have to tell them to flex. So here, watch this. Ready? Callie, flex. There's number one. Good. Let's go over this way. In. You're going to flex. Here's number two. I like that. All right, Danae, here's number three. Yes. And here, ladies and gentlemen, is number four with Brian. Oh, look at this. This is totally perfect. Check this out. See? You could have like kittens underneath here and they won't squish the kittens because they have structure and support to their legs. I think I got to get out from under here because I'm hearing heavy breathing. All right, so stay there. Whatever you do, these are coming back. Danae, here. And are you doing okay, Ann? Here you go. Brian, good. Because why wouldn't we leave Callie to the very end? I can't think of a better way to close the Spangler Effect with Table Tricks. Lift up. Ta-da! What a great way to do it. That wasn't bad at all. The next time we do a live event, we're going to start with this, and they're going to see how long they can hold it. I say 1 hour. That's what I'm going to say. All right, thanks for joining us for our live event with the Spangler Effect. Remember, we have our special books for sale as well. So it's a $30 value that's yours for free with a $50 purchase on our website. Just simply use the code BOOKS4, the number 4U. Add them to your cart. So if you're doing it online, add it to the cart, then put the promo code and it'll take it off at the end. It's a great gift for teachers or anybody who wants to do these silly little tricks. I mean, these meaningful science experiments. I have to buy them lunch and you have to go to another class or do something else. Thanks for joining us. You guys did great. Thank you. Thank you.